Hello everybody and welcome back. My name is Kari and today I am doing my mini reviews. For the sake of time, namely mine, because again, studying for the bar, which is a very common refrain for me this summer, as you may have noticed, I'm going to do the last 9 books I've read in one video, and then you guys don't have to watch 2 and I don't have to film 2, and to be honest, that's really nice for me. Anyway, let's get started. So the first one was one I read way back in May, because as you also may have noticed, my reviews don't go up very often. One is The Bloody Black Flag, which I gave 3 stars. The Bloody Black Flag is basically a pirate murder mystery. These 2 friends go on a whaler that was converted into a pirate ship because they have been pirates for a while, and so they're being chased up and down the American coast and they have to get away, so they join a pirate ship. One of the friends ends up dead, and the other one decides that he's going to get his vengeance for whoever killed his friend. I liked the writing style. It was a very short book. I liked the setting. But other than that, the vengeance seemed overblown because the book was so short that not enough of the character's relationship was put into writing for us to actually feel bad about Ezra's death. I also didn't particularly care about who killed Ezra, in the sense that when his friend went and when Spider went and found who did it, and there was a lot of intrigue, but it was almost very simplistic intrigue, so I didn't care so much about it. But all of that said, it was just kind of an entertaining book, pirate murder mystery, so it was a good Friday night. Then I read The Bear and the Nightingale by Katherine Arden, which I also gave 3 out of 5 stars. This is the first in her Winter Night trilogy, which is set in Russia in, I don't know, 1500s-ish? I honestly have no idea because there's no dates in this book. But I thoroughly enjoyed this book. It just felt very simple to me, which is why I gave it 3 out of 5 stars. It is about a young girl, Vasya, who can see the folkloric demons of Russia. Her father's wife dies and he remarries to this woman who is beyond devout. The new wife tries to get rid of all signs of Russian folklore, and Vasya basically has to save it. I thoroughly enjoyed that aspect of it, and my favorite part was definitely the atmosphere of the book. Katherine Arden has a way of writing where the cold of Russia just surrounds you. And it is the best possible thing, especially when it's 90 degrees out. So there's that. As I mentioned, it just seemed a little bit simple to me, and it wasn't something that necessarily stuck with me or made a deep impression on me. Hence the reason it got 3 out of 5, but it was a good book. I then read The Black Count, which I gave 5 out of 5 stars, by Tom Rice. The nonfiction about Alexander Dumas' father, Alex Dumas, who rose to the level of a general. I'm sorry about my speaking abilities, rose to the level of a general during the Napoleonic and French Revolution before that. It is an amazing book. There's a lot of personality put into the book. One of the things I loved most was the footnotes in it. He had a lot of just random little tidbits about history. There was one about Marie Antoinette's fashion sense. There was one about a certain town in France and a statue that was there. And then the other part that I really loved was that he brought himself into the narrative as the author. For example, one of the things was, when I was in this town that is well known for being the birthplace of Alex Dumas, he would start talking about his personal experiences as Tom Rice in that town trying to get the documents that he needed. And I thought that was a really cool way to do a biography. You don't usually see that. It's usually relatively dry. There might be some personality in there, which I love, but they rarely bring themselves into it. And that was just a unique perspective on it that I loved. Like I said, 5 out of 5, it was amazing to read about this guy who, according to legend, basically could reach up to the post above his head, with his horse between his legs, and then lift the horse with his legs, just holding onto this beam above his head. Take that with a grain of salt, obviously, but if that's even remotely true, this guy was amazing, and I could definitely see why Napoleon was slightly jealous. So, highly recommend this book. amazing biography. I then read Life in Motion by Misty Copeland. This is an autobiography of the first African-American principal ballerina with the ABT. This is the adult reader's version, and I read the young reader's version a while ago. This writing style is the same, it's very simple. This one definitely was targeted toward adult more, which I appreciated. It felt less childlike. I did almost expect the writing style to develop into something a little bit more sophisticated, but it didn't. And so that was surprising, but it's a good writing style. It flows really well and reads really fast. I loved reading all of her experiences because they're just so diverse and honestly amazing what she's done and how fast she was on point. Just everything about it is fantastic, and now I desperately, desperately would love to see her dance. So if you're looking for a quick biography that is about somebody who's not dead, I definitely recommend that one. Number 5 is The Rebel Queen by Michelle Moran, which I gave 4 out of 5 stars. This one follows a young woman who trains to become an elite warrior who guards Queen Lakshmi in the 1840s and 50s. She is part of an elite group of women warriors, a group of 10, that guards the queen. And the queen eventually loses her husband, and there's a British... Well, the British have invaded by then, but there's an insurrection that the British put down. And it happens during all of that. I was a little bit disappointed, I have to say, in the fact that it didn't follow the queen quite as much as I wanted it to. But that said, it was still a really good book because it showed you how these women were treated at the time and how respected these women warriors could be, which is amazing considering it's the 1840s and 50s and women have very little respect really anywhere. I loved that aspect of it, and Michelle Moran's writing is always fantastic. So good historical fiction, just don't go into it with the expectation that you're going to learn a lot about the queen as opposed to her elite bodyguards, which is what the back sounds like, but it's definitely more about the bodyguards than the queen. I then read The Bookworm by Mitch Silver, which I also gave 4 out of 5 stars. The Bookworm is about a young woman in Russia who finds, or is given rather, these cylinders from World War II and is told these have a huge impact on relations between Russia and the US today. Her twin brother is off in Alaska with an oil pipeline, and you ride along as the book follows her and her brother trying to figure out what happened to her coworker and what his coworker and how those cylinders from World War II have anything to do with the present. This book packed a huge punch for such a small book. It's about 300 pages, and I loved it. There were a couple of problems. I wish it were longer is the main one, but overall, the writing was fantastic. It read really fast, and it made sense, but I didn't see the twists coming. Disclaimer, I also don't look for the twists in books. The Bookworm just really brought history of World War II into modern day Russia and Alaska in a way that I could not have imagined. Also, the oil was surprisingly important, and I just thought that was great because I took the oil and gas class this last spring, and so it was fun to be able to kind of match those two things up. I then read The Jaguar Princess on my way back from Colorado by Claire Bell. I gave The Jaguar Princess 3 stars. It's about a young girl who is in Tenochtitlan, which is the capital of the Aztec Empire, before the Spanish come in and kill everybody. It's sometime when the Aztecs are expanding, except I don't know that much about Aztec history, so I can't tell you exact years. But this girl is a slave, she's sold off, and then they find out that she has some sort of special ability, and you go from there. I liked the general plot. The girl, whose name I can't recall, was fun to read about, but she wasn't my favorite. My biggest problem was probably, well, two. One, it just seemed a little bit slow and bland. And two, everybody in that book was a guy, except for her. And while I understand that men are a very important part of society and all that nonsense, there should have been more women in that book. We literally only see one woman, and she's mentioned maybe 3 times. And for whatever reason, that grated on my nerves in The Jaguar Princess. So, good book, but not my favorite. 3 out of 5. Oh my goodness, I can't talk. I then read Radium Girls, which was another 5 out of 5 for me. And Radium Girls is about the young women who were painting watch faces during the 1910s and 1920s. Huge war effort, and then after that, just everybody wanted them because they glow in the dark or something. I don't really know why they wanted them, but they were really huge big. So it's a nonfiction book that reads very much like a fiction book. It is so easy to read, it's amazing. And the other thing is, you really feel for these girls. The first third of it, them painting it, and you hear the refrain lip dip point over and over and over, along with the tiny amounts of radium are healthy for you, because that's what everybody said. Radium was a miracle cure in the 1910s and 20s, and so dipping a paintbrush onto your tongue and then into the radium paint and then painting and then repeating lip dip paint was not seen as anything that was going to get them killed. The second third of the book was them figuring out that there's something wrong. A lot of their problems start with their mouths. Their teeth start falling out, and the more you remove the teeth, the faster it decays. And some of their hips fused, basically, so it was really hard to read that, but they start figuring out their problems, and then they hire a lawyer, and I really loved the legal aspect of it, simply because I've been through law school at this point, and it's always fun to see how it applies in the real world. And then the third part of it was them dying off, or the restitution they got, if any. It was definitely a hard book to read, because many of these women died very young. They couldn't have children, or if they could, it was incredibly hard for them. There was one woman who, during the legal process, they had a bedside hearing because she couldn't actually physically get to the court. But amazing, amazing book. Loved it, and it taught me so much about women that I'd never heard of and about a time that I didn't know about either. And then the last one is Relics of the Dead by Arianna Franklin. This book takes place in 1176 under Henry II's rule in the UK, specifically Wales, and they find 2 skeletons under Glastonbury Abbey. Henry wants to know, are these Guinevere and Arthur or aren't they? Because if they are Guinevere and Arthur, the Welsh people won't have a savior that's coming back to help them get rid of English kings. And if they're not Guinevere and Arthur, then the Welsh are probably gonna start fighting again, and no English king wanted that ever. He hires his mistress of the arts of the dead, Adelia, to come and tell him who these skeletons are. It is not at all what you think. The writing style was very different, but it was really fun to read. I also really enjoyed the setting because I don't read a lot of books set in 1176. Most of my books, not gonna lie, and I'm sure this will come as a shock to you, are set in the Tudor era. So 1176 is very far out of my normal reading range, but it was fantastic. I loved the diverse cast of characters. There was an Arab man who traveled with Adelia, and their pretense was that he couldn't speak English, and that he was a doctor so that she could be the doctor, except that she just pretended she was translating for him. And it worked out really well, and it was hysterical to see how it played out in some of these situations. Adelia also has a daughter, and the father of her daughter was a bishop. There were a lot of different aspects to this. The religion was also huge, because obviously Catholicism is basically the only religion in Europe at the time, besides maybe some of the more pagan religions. So I loved that aspect of it. It was very interesting. The one problem that I did have with it, though, was that, spoiler, at the end she seemed to be willing to give up independence and freedom and intelligence for romance. And I understand, to an extent, giving up your freedom in 1176 as a woman for the sake of your daughter, so that you can go and live with a guy and he can take care of you. But at the same time, Adelia's personality and her decision at the end came across as extremely discordant. So I still have a bit of a problem with that. However, I found out that there are 2 other books in that series. Again, I read series all out of whack, so I have to go read the first 2 of this series now, but it reads fine as a standalone. They usually do if you don't know they're a series. Anyway, I know this video is a little bit longer than my normal review videos. I know I'm speaking very quickly, and I do apologize about that, and I also apologize about the fact that I'm stumbling over my words. It seems like every other sentence. My brain is a little bit fried. I have been studying for 4 hours already, and I have another 4 hours to go. when this video is being filmed, which is super fun. But at any rate, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, give it a big thumbs up down below. If you want to see more content like this, hit that subscribe button down below. I post every Tuesday and Saturday, sometimes with some bonus videos. So if you want to be notified every time I post, hit that little bell icon. But I will leave my Goodreads link down below, and until my next video, bye.